Well, it seems that my phone thought the video was too long, so this is part two of Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, The Dark Mark. Winky began to rock backwards and forward on the ground, her breath coming in sharp bursts. Harry was reminded forcibly of Dobby in his moments of terrified disobedience. "As you see, Elf, the Dark Mark was conjured here a short while ago," said Mr. Diggory. "And you were discovered moments later, right beneath it. An explanation, if you please."
I is not doing it, sir," Winky gasped. "I is not knowing how, sir."
"You were found with a wand in your hand," barked Mr. Diggory, brandishing it in front of her, as the wand caught the green light that was filling the clearing from the skull above. Harry recognized it. "Hey, that's mine," he said. Everyone in the clearing looked at him. "Excuse me," said Mr. Diggory incredulously. "That's my wand," said Harry. "I dropped it." "You dropped it," repeated Mr. Diggory in a disbelief. "Is this a confession? You threw it aside after you conjured the Dark Mark?" "Amos, think who you're talking to," said Mr. Weasley very angrily. "Is Harry Potter likely to conjure the Dark Mark?" "Of course not," mumbled Mr. Diggory. "Sorry, carried away." "I didn't drop it there anyways," said Harry, jerking his thumb towards the trees beneath the skull. "I missed it right after we got into the wood." "So," said Mr. Diggory, his eyes hardening as he turned to look at Winky again. So," said Mr. Diggory, his eyes hardening as he turned to look at Winky again, cowering at his feet. "You found this wand, eh, Elf? And you picked it up and thought you'd have some fun with it, did you?"
"I is not doing magic with it, sir," squeaked Winky, tears streaming down the sides of her face, down her squished and bulbous nose. "I is just picking it up, sir. It's not making the dark mark, sir. I is not knowing how."
"It wasn't her," said Hermione. She looked very nervous, speaking up in front of all these ministry wizards, yet determined all the same. Winky's got a squeaky little voice, and her voice, and the voice we heard doing the incantation, was much deeper. She looked round at Harry and Ron, appealing for their support. "It didn't sound anything like Winky, did it?" "No," said Harry, shaking his head. "It definitely did not sound like an elf." "Yeah, it's a human voice," said Ron. "Well, we'll see," growled Diggory, looking unimpressed. There's a simple way of discovering the last spell a wand performed, elf. Did you know that?" Winky trembled and shook her head frantically, her ears flapping as Mr. Diggory raised his own wand again and placed the tip to the tip of Harry's. "Prior incantato," roared Mr. Diggory. Harry heard Hermione gasp, horrified, as a gigantic serpent-tongued skull erupted from the point where the two wands met. But it was a mere shadow of the green skull high above them. It looked as though it was made of thick gray smoke, a ghost of a spell. "Delirious!" said Diggory, shouted. And the smoky skull vanished in a wisp of smoke. "So," Mr. Diggory, with a kind of savage triumph, looking down upon Winky, who was still shaking convulsively.
"I is not doing it," she squeaked, her eyes rolling in terror. I is not knowing how. I is a good elf. I isn't using wands. I isn't knowing how."
"You've been caught red-handed, elf," Mr. Diggory roared, caught up with the guilty wand in his hand. "Amos," Mr. Weasley said loudly, "think about it. Precious few wizards know how to do that spell. Where would she have learnt it?" "Perhaps Amos is suggesting that Mr. Crouch," cold anger in every syllable, "that I routinely teach my servants to conjure the dark mark." There is a deeply unpleasant silence. Amos Diggory looked horrified. Mr. Crouch, no, not at all. You have now come very close to accusing the two people in the clearing who are at least the least likely to conjure the dark mark, barked Mr. Crouch. Harry Potter and myself. I suppose you are familiar with the boy's story, Amos? Of course, everybody knows, muttered Mr. Diggory, looking highly discomfited. And I trust you remember that many proofs I have given over the long career that I despise and detest the dark arts and those who practice them, Mr. Crouch shouted, his eyes bulging again. Mr. Crouch, I never suggested you had anything to do with it, muttered Amos Diggory, now reddened behind his scrubby brown beard. If you accuse my elf, you accuse me, Diggory, shouted Mr. Crouch. Where else would she have learnt to conjure it? She might have picked it up anywhere. Precisely, Amos, said Mr. Weasley. She might have picked it up anywhere. Winky? He turned kindly towards the elf, but she flinched as though he too was shouting at her. Where exactly did you find Harry's wand? Winky was twisting the hem of her tea towel so violently that it was now fraying beneath her fingers. I is finding it there, sir, she whispered. There in the tree, sir. You see, Amos, said Mr. Weasley, whoever conjured the dark mark could have disapparated right there after they'd done it, leaving Harry's wand behind. A clever thing to do, not to use their own wand, which could have betrayed them. And Winky here had the misfortune to come across the wand moments later and picked it up. But then she would have been feet away from the real culprit, said Mr. Diggory impatiently. Elf, did you see anybody? Winky began to tremble worse than ever. Her giant eyes flickered from Mr. Diggory to Ludo Bagman and on to Mr. Crouch. Then she gulped and said, I is seeing no one, sir. No, oh, sorry. And then she gulped and said, I is seeing no one, sir. No one. Amos said Mr. Crouch curtly. I am fully aware that in the ordinary course of events, you would want to take Winky to your department for questioning. I ask you, however, to allow me to deal with her. Mr. Diggory looked as though he didn't think much of the suggestion at all, but it was clear to Harry and Mr. Crouch that Mr. Crouch was such an important member of the ministry that he did not dare refuse him. You may rest assured that she will be punished, Mr. Crouch said coldly.
Master,
Winky stammered, looking up at Mr. Crouch, her eyes brimming with tears.
Master, please.
Mr. Crouch stared back, his face somehow sharpened, each line upon it more deeply etched. There was no pity in his gaze. Winky has behaved tonight in a manner I would not have believed possible, he said slowly. I told her to remain in the tent. I told her to stay there while I went to go sort out the trouble. When I find that she disobeyed me, this means close.
No!
shrieked Winky, protesting, prostrating herself at Mr. Crouch's feet.
No, Master! No clothes! No clothes!
Harry knew that the only way to turn a house elf free was to present it with proper garments. It is painful to see the way Winky clutched her tea towel and sobbed over Mr. Crouch's feet.
But she was frightened, Hermione burst out angrily, glaring at Mr. Crouch. Your elf's scared of heights, and those wizards in masks were levitating people. You can't blame her for wanting to get out of their way.
Mr. Crouch took a step backwards, freeing himself from the contact with his elf, whom he was surveying as though she was something filthy and rotten that was contaminating his overshined shoes.
I have no use for a house elf who disobeys me, he said coldly, looking up at Hermione. I have no use for a servant who forgets what is due to her master and to her master's reputation.
Winky was crying so hard that her sobs etched over the clearing. There was a very nasty silence, which was ended by Mr. Weasley, who said quietly, "Well, I think I'll take my lot back to the tent, if nobody's got any objections. Amos, that wand's told us all it can. If Harry could have it back, please." Mr. Diggory handed Harry's wand, and Harry pocketed it. "Come on, you three," said Mr. Weasley, said quietly. But Hermione didn't seem to want to move, her eyes still upon the sobbing elf. "Hermione," said Mr. Weasley, more urgently. She turned and followed Harry and Ron out of the clearing and off through the trees. "What's going to happen to Winky?" said Hermione the moment they had left the clearing. "I don't know," said Mr. Weasley. "The way they were treating her," said Hermione furiously. "Mr. Diggory calling her elf all the time, and Mr. Crouch, he knows she didn't do it, and he's still going to sack her. He didn't care how frightened she had been or how upset she was. It was like she wasn't even human." "Well, she's not," said Ron. Hermione rounded on him. "That doesn't mean she hasn't got feelings, Ron. It's disgusting the way..." "Hermione, I agree with you," Mr. Weasley said quickly, beckoning her on. "But now is not the time to discuss elf rights. I want to get back to the tent as fast as we can. What happened to the others?" "We lost them in the dark," said Ron. "Dad, why is everyone so uptight about the skull thing?" "I'll explain everything back at the tent," said Mr. Weasley tensely. But when they reached the edge of the woods, their progress was impeded. A large crowd of frightened-looking witches and wizards was congregated there, and when they saw Mr. Weasley coming towards them, many of them surged forward. "What's going on in there? Who conjured it? Arthur, it's not him!" "Of course it's not him," said Mr. Weasley impatiently. "We don't know who it was. It looks like they disapparated." "No, now excuse me, please. I want to get to bed." He led Harry, Ron, Hermione through the crowds and back to the campsite. All was quiet now. There was no sign of any masked wizards, though several ruined tents were still smoking. Charlie's head was poking out of the boys' tent. "Dad, what's going on?" he called through the dark. "Fred, George, Ginny got back okay, but the others?" "I've got them here," said Mr. Weasley, bending down and entering the tent. Harry, Ron, and Hermione entered after them. Bill was sitting at the small kitchen table, holding a bedsheet to his arm, which was now bleeding profusely. Charlie had a large rip in his shirt, and Percy was sporting a bloody nose. Fred, George, Ginny looked unhurt, though shaken. "Did you get them, Dad?" said Bill sharply. "The person who conjured the dark mark?" "No," said Mr. Weasley. "We found Barty Crouch's elf holding Harry's wand. But we're none the wiser about who actually conjured the mark." "What?" said Bill, Charlie, and Pearsley together. "Harry's wand," said Fred. "Mr. Crouch's elf," said Percy, sounding thunderstruck. With some assistance from Harry, Ron, and Hermione, Mr. Weasley explained what had happened in the woods. When they had finished their story, Percy swelled indignantly. "Well, Mr. Crouch is quite right to get rid of an elf like that," he said, "running away when he expressly told her not to, embarrassing him in front of the whole ministry. How would that have looked if she had... had up in front of the Department of the Regulation and Control? She didn't do anything. She was just in the wrong place at the wrong time," Hermione snapped at Percy, who looked very taken aback. Hermione had always gotten on fairly well with Percy, better indeed than the others. Hermione, a wizard in Mr. Crouch's position, can't afford a house elf who's going to run amok with a wand, said Percy pompously, recovering himself. "She didn't run amok," shouted Hermione. "She just picked it up off the ground." "Look, can someone just explain what that skull thing was?" said Ron impatiently. It wasn't hurting anybody. Why is it such a big deal? I told you. It's you-know-who's symbol, Ron, said Hermione, before anyone could answer. I read about it in The Rise and Fall of the Dark Arts. And it hasn't been seen in 13 years. And Mr. Weasley... Sorry. And it hasn't been seen for 13 years, said Mr. Weasley quietly. Of course, people... panicked. It was almost like seeing you-know-who back again. I don't get it, said Ron, frowning. I mean, it's still only a shape in the sky. Ron, you-know-who and his followers sent a dark mark into the air whenever they killed, said Mr. Weasley. The terror it inspired, you have no idea. You're too young. Just picture coming home and finding the dark mark hovering over your house, not knowing, and knowing what's about to find inside, Mr. Weasley winced. Everyone's worst fear, the very worst. There was silence for a moment. Then Bill, removing the sheet from his arm, checked on his cut, said, Well, didn't help us tonight, whoever conjured it. It scared the Death Eaters away the moment they saw it. They all disapparated before we got near enough to unmask any of them. We caught the Robertuses before they hit the ground, though. They're having their memories modified right now. Death Eaters? Said Harry. What are Death Eaters? It's what you-know-who supporters call themselves, said Bill. I think we saw what's left of them tonight. The ones who managed to keep themselves out of Azkaban, anyways. We can't prove it was them, Bill, said Mr. Weasley, though it probably was, he said hopelessly. Yeah, I bet it was, said Ron suddenly. Dad, we met Draco Malfoy in the woods, and he was as good as told us his dad was one of those nutters in masks. And we all know the Malfoys were right in with you-know-who. But what were Voldemort's supporters, Harry began. Everybody flinched, like most of the wizarding world. The Weasleys always avoided saying Voldemort's name. Sorry, said Harry quickly. What were you-know-who supporters up to, levitating muggles? I mean, what's the point? The point, said Mr. Weasley, with a hollow laugh. Harry, that's the idea of fun. Half of the muggle killings back when you-know-who was in power were done for fun. I suppose they had a few drinks tonight and couldn't resist reminding us of all the, reminding us all that lots of them were still at large. A nice little reunion for them, he finished, disgustingly. But if they were Death Eaters, why did they disapparate when they saw the dark mark, said Ron. They'd have been pleased to see him, wouldn't they? Use your brains, Ron, said Bill. If they really were Death Eaters, they worked really hard to keep out of Azkaban when you-know-who lost power. And told all sorts of lies about him forcing them to kill and torture people. I bet they'd even be more frightened than the rest of us to see him come back. They denied they ever been involved with him, and he lost when he lost his power and went back to their daily lives. I don't reckon he'd be overpleased with them, do you? So, whoever conjured the dark mark, said Hermione slowly, were they doing it to show support for the Death Eaters or to scare them away? Your guess is as good as ours, Hermione, said Mr. Weasley. But I'll tell you this. It was only the Death Eaters who ever knew how to conjure it. I'd be very surprised if the person who did it hadn't been a Death Eater once, even if they're not now. Listen, it's really late. And if your mother hears what happened, she'll be worried sick. We get a few more hours of sleep and then try to get an early port key out of here. Harry got back to his bunk with his head buzzing. He knew he ought to feel exhausted. It was nearly 3 a.m, but he felt wide awake and worried. 3 days ago, it felt like much longer, but it had only been 3 days. He had been awoken with his scar burning, and tonight, for the first time in 13 years, Lord Voldemort Mark had appeared in the sky. What did these things mean? He thought the letter had been written to Sirius before leaving Privet Drive. Sorry. He thought about the letter he had written to Sirius before leaving Private Drive. Would Sirius have got it yet? When would he reply? Harry lay looking at the canvas, but no flying fantasies came to him now to ease him to sleep, and it was a long time before Charlie's snores filled the tent and Harry finally dozed off. Thanks, guys.